Well, from overseas intervention to cases of entrapment here at home, we all know that the government has been relentless in its mission to find and catch potential terrorists. One tactic the Federal Bureau of Investigation uses is hiring informants to infiltrate communities where suspects live and catch them in the act, or at least talk about possibly committing an action in the future. The problem with this approach, critics say, is that the criminal activity would never have taken place if it weren't for the FBI informants egging them on. Some examples: Mohammed Mahmoud was arrested in November of 2010 after he attempted to detonate a bomb at the Portland Christmas tree lighting ceremony. This next gentleman was detained on October 17, 2012 for attempting to use car bombs to blow up the New York Federal Reserve building. And then there's the Cleveland Five. They were arrested on April 31st, 2012 after they attempted to blow up Ohio 82 bridge over the Cuyahoga Valley National Park. So, could the FBI be creating terrorists instead of catching them? Our next guest has done extensive research on this topic and details it all in his book, The Terror Factory. There it is on the screen. Trevor Aronson joins us now in our D.C. studio. Trevor, it's great to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
What inspired you to write this book?
You know, beginning in 2006, I began to see these cases that the Bureau and the Department of Justice was putting forward as a dangerous plot that they had foiled, a terrorist who was about to attack a large building, a terrorist that was about to attack a public square. And what I began to see was that none of these people actually had the capability. It was the informant or the undercover agent who found people who were on the fringes of society and at times offered them inducements, but then provided all of the means necessary to move forward with their crime. You know, for example, these men never had access to weapons, but through these elaborate sting operations, the FBI provided these weapons. And so this book documents the of the 500 cases, the terrorism cases the FBI and the DOJ have brought since 9/11, how many of them involved real terrorists? And so many more were actually these sting operations. Actually, 150 defendants since 9/11 were involved in sting operations that where they never had the capacity to commit crimes on their own.
So you're saying that the FBI, without the help of the FBI, they didn't have the resources, they didn't have the weapons, they couldn't have done it without the help of the FBI.
Absolutely. You know, there are examples where some of these men didn't even have enough money to pay their rent. In other cases, they were mentally ill. There was a man caught in a sting operation in Seattle, for example, with schizoaffective disorder, which means that he has trouble distinguishing between reality and fantasy. Well, someone like that is obviously very susceptible to an informant who says, hey, we should move forward with a terrorism plot. You know, I can make this happen. This is what we should do. And what's happening is that through these sting operations, the FBI is drawing in people on the fringes who are very susceptible, who for whatever reason hate the United States, but on their own have no capacity to commit a crime, to commit an act of terrorism. And in the meantime, real terrorists such as Faisal Shahzad, who came close to bombing Times Square, they aren't being caught in these sting operations. Ultimately, these sting operations are drawing in people who are odious, who are hateful, but on their own have no capacity for terrorism.
Interesting. So you're saying these people, these examples that you point out, are these kind of out of the norm, or is this the norm, that these are the people that are targeted?
This is the new normal. I mean, in a sense, when, you know, you mentioned Kwasi Nafis, for example, the man who tried to detonate a bomb at the Federal Reserve building. You know, here was a guy who had nothing. His father had spent all his money to bring him over to Bangladesh. He never had access to any weapons. He never had any contact with Al-Qaeda or a terrorist organization. It was actually an undercover agent who posed as an Al-Qaeda operative, provided everything he needed, provided the bomb, provided the transportation, provided the money, and that allowed him to commit this crime. What we're seeing more and more in these sting operations is people who are on the fringes, who are desperate, sometimes mentally ill, and they're the ones being caught in these sting operations. What we aren't seeing are people like that, people who are desperate, who want to do something, commit an act of terrorism, and them finding on their own an Al-Qaeda operative who provides the means. In all of these cases, it's only the FBI that's providing the means and opportunity for these crimes.
Now, your book looks into who exactly these informants are, these people that the government is hiring to be these informants. Who do they usually pick to carry out these jobs?
You know, what I point out is that there's a real question of whether the government is using criminals who are worse than the ones they're targeting. You know, for example, in some cases they've used, in one case they used a child molester in Seattle. In another case they used an accused murderer from Pakistan who had declared bankruptcy and didn't tell the court that he had $500,000 overseas. In many cases, they've used drug dealers, they've used people with criminal records, who ultimately target people who do not have criminal records, but who say they want to commit an act of terrorism. And these informants, who at times have a financial incentive, you know, informants can make $100,000 or more in a terrorism case, you know, they have a financial incentive to find someone to commit a crime, and ultimately that's what they're able to do. And I think this raises a real question about justice in the United States. This is as much a story about terrorism as it is about justice, because how fair is it that ultimately the informants that are targeting these men have this great financial incentive to find people who want to commit acts of terrorism, and as a result of that, they're ultimately finding people who are on the fringes of society who, as I said, are economically desperate or mentally ill.
How common are these cases of entrapment?
You know, of the 500 prosecutions that the government has brought since 9/11, the majority are actually minor crimes. They are, you know, someone wanted for immigration violations that's later accused of terrorism or lying to the FBI. What we can say is that of the 500, 150 are actually sting operations. And then, you know, we can only count perhaps a handful, such as Faisal Zad or Najib Olazazi, who came close to bombing the New York City subway system, as actual true real terrorists who pose a direct threat.
Interesting. You know, these examples, they're part of this terrorism prevention program, as it's called. If these people pose serious threats, is the government justified in carrying out these missions to stop them before they carry out an attack? I know you had mentioned a lot of them are not, but in some cases, is it justified?
The government's view is that they want to stop the terrorists of tomorrow today. So they want to find them just before they act. What I criticize in the book is that there's really little evidence to suggest that were it not for the FBI coming in and providing the means and opportunity, they never could have on their own received the means and the opportunity. You know, for example, there have been more people killed since 9/11 by lone gunmen than there have been by so-called lone wolf terrorists with al-Qaeda sympathies. And so what that suggests is that they're actually to commit a horrific act of terrorism in the United States isn't difficult. It doesn't require a large amount of means. But we're not seeing terrorists with al-Qaeda sympathies commit these crimes. Instead, it's lone gunmen, for example. So that either suggests that the FBI is perfect in its mission in pulling off terrorists of tomorrow today, or that the threat that they pose is not what the government has portrayed them that to be.
Interesting. You know, your book has sparked a good deal of controversy. Those that really commend you for your research and what you've revealed, others really do defend these FBI sting operations. Why do you think it's so divisive?
I think that what this has brought forward is a divide within the FBI. There is a lot of disagreement within the Bureau about whether these programs are the most effective, whether the efficacy of these programs is worth the effort and the expense involved. You know, critics of these programs criticize them for the same reasons I do, that there's a question of whether these people would have committed acts of terrorism on their own, whether the FBI, through these elaborate sting operations, is ultimately getting them involved in crimes that on their own they never would have had any opportunity to get involved with. That said, the people who defend this policy, they believe that this is a way of getting terrorists off the street now. Where I criticize that argument is that ultimately they cite as in the defense of this program, real terrorists, Faisal Sajjad, Najib Olazazi, and none of these men were actually caught in sting operations. You know, none of the real terrorists that pose threats were ever aware of by the FBI through sting operations. Ultimately, sting operations aren't catching people who likely would have committed an act of terrorism tomorrow.
Now, why do you think the government has resorted to using this tactic and using it more often?
I think this is a bureaucratic problem. Every year, Congress gets $3 billion to fight counterterrorism. FBI gets $3 billion from Congress to fight counterterrorism, and the FBI can't spend $3 billion and go back to Congress and say, hey, we spent all your money and we didn't find any terrorists. These sting operations provide a very convenient mechanism for the FBI to show the Congress and the public, hey, we're keeping you safe. Here's a terrorist attack that was thwarted. You know, if you look at FBI Director Robert Mueller's testimony before Congress the last few years, he consistently cites these terrorism sting operations. He talks about the elaborate scope of the plots, how horrific they would have been, but he never fully discloses to Congress the fact that these people never, on their own, never would have had the capacity. It was an FBI informant incentivized by money who ultimately provided the means and the opportunity for these crimes.
Very interesting, Trevor. Great to have you on and shed some light on this issue. That was Trevor Aronson, author of The Terror Factory.
Thank you.